сьогодні вона є і в рамках нашої публічної програми, а також і в рамках серії лекцій для студентів, архітекторів і дизайнерів. Доктор Анна Фальшевська, яка приїхала до нас з Кракова, з Польщі. Ми з Анною знаємося давно. І Анна, власне, розказувала нам про свої цікаві дослідження і запропонувала на основі своїх досліджень прочитати лекції для наших студентів. І ми вирішили співпрацю між США і Анною Олешевською ще розширити на нашу співпрацю, яку ми маємо з Кракова в планах мистецьких практик, і запропонувати такий курс для спільної для наших студентів, архітекторів і дизайнерів. Отже, це є така серія лекцій, що ознайомлює з концептуальними основами обробки зображень. І тут є спеціальний фокус на архітекторах і дизайнерах, які, власне, цікавляться технологічними експериментами з різними матеріалами, з стрілками, з фільтрами, з методами освітлення. Анна якби не аналізує це, Анна концептуалізує ці нові підходи технологічних обробок зображень. І дивиться на те, як вони впливають на цей матеріальний світ, в якому ми живемо. І з одного боку, якщо про це говорити і думати, так видається, що це якби є тема не для архітекторів і не для дизайнерів, але ці постійні трансформації зображень, які відбуваються під впливом нових технологій, наприклад, як штучного інтелекту, так, вони є дуже сильно присутні в нашому світі. Ми їх не завжди бачимо, вони є часами приховані, вони є часами дуже візуально видані. Це вже є той світ, в якому ми живемо, і це вже є ті речі, з якими треба рахуватися і архітекторам, які проєктують простори, і дизайнерам, які проєктують також свої простори. Ця серія лекцій ґрунтується, власне, на дослідженні Анни Олешевської, яка вже оформлена в книжку її докторське дослідження. Книжка має дуже таку інтригуючу назву. Це книга не про зображення, експерименти з обробки зображень та машинного бачення. І, власне, ця робота почалася в Анни з інтерв'ю з експертами з різних сфер про те, як про технології цифрових обробок зображень, і з цього виникла ця її тема дослідження. Про вивчення взагалі технології обробки зображень є багато, і це, власне, те, що Анну цікавить, тому що всі ці технології оцифрування, алгоритмів, про це дуже багато написано. І Анна, власне, говорить в тому дослідженні, що давайте подивимося на те, що робиться не за камерою, а те, що робиться перед камерою. Тобто, як ці обробки цифрових зображень, я би можу так сказати, це моя інтерпретація, вже втручається в цей наш реальний світ, і як вони формують його. І для публічної лекції ми вибрали третю лекцію Анни, тому що вона нам видалася актуальною з точки зору того, де ми зараз є, а ми зараз є в війні. І сьогодні ми будемо говорити про воєнні технології і як вони формують певні візуальні речі і як ці технології, які розробляються, як є воєнних цілей, можуть і використовуються в реальному світі. Так, також, можливо, на дискусії поговоримо про те, які в цьому є плюси, мінуси, які в цьому є небезпеки. Доктор Анна Ольшевська є викладачкою університету наукових технологій Кракова. Вона вивчала мистецтво гуманітаристику, і вона працює в галузі візуальної студії, аналізу документів, візуальних зображень, а також працює зі сферою історії науки і також має досвід кураторський і декілька висновок власне в цій сфері історії науки. Дуже дякую, Маня, що ти запропонувала нам це речі. Я вчора говорила студентам, і сьогодні, напевно, ще раз повторюся, що я не люблю вживати слово унікальне, воно таке стало дуже маркетингове, та, і для мене завжди за словом унікальним стоїть щось таке дуже, направду, банальне. Та? Але, направду, ці лекції, які ми слухаємо цього тижня зі студентами, вони є, як на мене, унікальними, вони є тими, про які не говорять. І навіть якщо поговорити, пошукати сіни лікову зараз, ну, про це майже в мене не дані інформації. Книга Анни вийде англійською мовою, і я сподіваюся, що ми будемо її мати в бібліотеці не лише, тому наперед робимо і рекламу книжки, і нашої бібліотеки. Дуже сподіваємося, що ця ситуація стане таким початком, і можливо це перше, але не останнє раз, коли Анна Ольшевська приїжджає до нас до школи, також до Академії мистецтв. Дуже дякую і передаю слово. Ще один момент, лекція буде англійською мовою, але Анна розуміє вільно українську, тому ставити питання чи свої коментарі, якісь рефлексії можна також українською мовою.
You have a quest, like you have a commission to build an office. optimized acoustic performance of this. Yeah, so we are doing, we are trying to do the parallel thing, but thinking about what is happening in front of the cameras, in front of the advanced visual systems, in front of the professional visual equipment, etc., etc. So telescopes, microscopes, IR cameras, and others. So today, I would like to invite you to speak about and to think together also about a possibility of using this path of design, like adjusting this path of design to a dangerous game, which is a game of concealment and visibility. And as we know, the starting point for this is in the studies of military technologies, which we are maybe not going very much into, but we will speak about the spillover of what is advanced visibility and concealment technology into the broader use. So we will look at the fields of design that can be actually organized along this physical, this line, the plots where we see the different different spectra and different different spectral bands of electromagnetic field. So we are no longer only inside this little window of visible light, like for the classical the classical works for visual designers. I propose that we start to think within what might be called multispectral design or extended visibility range. So we will try to involve also all these ways of doing, and especially I'm very much, I would like to also encourage you and drag you into that thinking in terms of practice all the time, like how you experiment, how you practice, how you interview. Like how we can practice design and methodologies practice for architects and for designers while thinking about all that can be done with infrared, microwave, so it can go lower into lower frequencies and also to higher frequencies, including ultraviolet and X-ray. So it is not purely visual. And here, with some examples, what I would like to do, I will briefly like introduce where we are in the state of art. So where we are in the research for the let's say visual media, visual culture, in terms of how this field can guide us toward this kind of speculative design works, and then I will try to also put on the table in front of us some basic building blocks of these technologies that are available right now. So when you look at the resources, if we think of ourselves, like we may also think about this lecture as an introduction for a workshop, let's say. Yeah, so if we want to make a workshop on extended design, consumer and visibility, what kind of resources do we have? What can we find for ourselves? Being here and now at Fine Arts Academy in the Kharkiv School of Architecture. And then for the last part, I would like to give the floor to you and talk about the possibilities of using these resources for the design purpose. How you see, what kinds of problems, issues, and what kinds of affordances, possibilities can you spot in this area? So let's start. In terms of studies that actually go to the problems of concealment and visibility, we should first look to the automated media theories and surveillance studies, actually. I would recommend to start with this. And here, we would find a series of books that usually focus on this on this framework where you have like advanced algorithmic systems that can capture biometric data and work as a surveillance systems in a mass for mass scale. Going there, we find yesterday actually we spoke about this a bit about this Grégoire Chamayou, the theory of drones. Like to recommend some writers, some readings, and say, okay, we may start with the theory of drone, Chamayou, 2013, and then go also to the publications like this essay, visual essay by Sanela Jakic under the Kulatif case, which is like 2023, which is like 10 years after Chamayou. And then if we compare these two. These two studies, we will see what we can get from the library. And what we can get from the library from the meta theory are basically two things. The one is that it is brought about by Chamayou, his theory of drones, which tells us about the capabilities, I would say, of the civilian surveillance systems. Chamayou builds this his theory around around the very nice, very poetic, I would say, even term, which is coined as a pattern of life. So he says that this surveillance technology that we observed in 2013 in the mass use for the police stations, for the security in public area. This is works on in this framework of patterns of life observation, which means that, and he points out here in his studies a very important, I believe, point that. The data processing capabilities of such mass systems are quite limited, and to make them work, it is often there is an often used algorithmic pattern, which means that this kind of systems are established, are set up to learn our behavior and learn the our pattern of life, how we move, where we move, what we do on a daily basis. So what is happening once nothing special is happening? And then react for the outliers, like react to all the behaviors that are out of the scheme. So the first we pump lots of data into the system, so it says, and we observe patterns of life, and then if something unconventional happens, or something unusual happens. And the good example for this would be any like basic systems that is set up to watch the parking road in, under the market somewhere, where you got lots of cars parked around, and no one bothers to pay anyone anymore to watch all these cameras 24/7. So then you can think about the system that will track the people who are moving through the parking lot, and once the movement of a person is unusual, in terms like you don't get the shortest path from the entrance to the market, to the mall, to a specific car, but you see someone wandering around, yeah? Then the alarm starts, and this is what the Chamayou actually speaks about. There is not enough capacity in the systems to process everything, although it might be even possible in terms of what we have the methodology of machine learning, but it is easier to set an alarm for the outliers. So anything that is unusual, we beyond. And this is going to be actually the first hint for us as designers when we are speaking about our workshops or our like hypothetical design, is this pattern of life important as a strategy for us. And like, are we going to work on the patterns of life and the alarms that are set up with the outliers? Another, and you can probably imagine like what does it mean for an artist or architect or designer in terms of like variety of forms and the liberty of differentiated strategies of design and so on. The second one, which I recommend you very much, by the way, the editor Axioma. I don't know if you happen to know them. Do you know Axioma Institute in Ljubljana? You know Axioma? How you know Axioma? Yeah? I discovered them during pandemia and I'm absolutely psycho fan of Axioma, I must say. So this is advertising right now. That's all that is. This is an NGOs organization and a community of curators, researchers based in Ljubljana, who are introducing and working, they've been doing this for years, with a long-term project which is a tactics and practice. So that's why I also think that it fits to what we are doing here. So tactics and practice, you know, we have this theoretical distinction between strategies that are imposed by the big players in technology and tactics that are actually made by bottom up, yeah, by human, by individuals themselves. So Axioma works on tactics and practice in a long-term projects, like they take something like hyper-employment and automation for 1 year. Unreal data, real effects now, and so on, so on. So they take one topic and they work with number of people, artists, designers, and also theoreticians, with a series of lectures, etc., etc., and with exhibitions, and they publish wonderful small literature books, small books and essays, which are like deliverables from these discussions. And 2023, in Axioma publications, we find like very interesting the visual essay by Sanela Jahic, which shows like which can be actually quoted as a continuation of these studies of surveillance that have a long tradition, like a surveillance society and then tactical solutions for this, which is a catalog. The catalog of the cases of putting citizens, like from the different countries, so there are many different examples from Southern America, from US, also from Europe, under the normative calculative gaze of mostly of biometric systems. Like what can happen to us? Imagine we are traveling somewhere around and getting to different situations and places, like crossing the border, going to the hospital, buying insurance, anything like this. And what when our, especially she puts a focus on like biometric, where our biometric identity and how our biometric identity is captured. So this is true. Surveillance study and biometrics. So this literature, actually, the state of the art goes very close. It develops very close to the question of the face, like issues, social impact of biometric technologies, face recognitions, and so on. And there is also, but the studies of surveillance, they have a very, very long line of research. They date back to the 70s, like post-structuralism, post-structural narrations, and Michel Foucault, and so on. Mm-hmm. But there are also very interesting parts that is brought to us by media artists, and especially those people who are into anti-surveillance tactics and practices. So usually these are like, ephemeric projects that tell us something about at a certain point where we when we go to these technologies, what can we do in order to like reclaim our liberty to have any option to become visible or become invisible. Yeah, so anti-surveillance status. Agency, this was the word. So it's about agency. And the very famous project, like often quoted project here, is Adam Harvey, that does a look, which is a fun project about how can you think about hairstyle and makeup in a urban area once you consider yourself, you would like to become invisible for face recognition algorithms in 2010. So Harvey, who started his artistic career as a photographer, delved into these technologies and joined his forces with designers and stylists who actually proposed the numbers in a very serious that looks like steampunk, or not very steampunk, like these futuristic haircuts and makeups that are absolutely flashy. You cannot forget such a person if you met her on the street. That would be impossible. So for humans, this is fun part. So for humans, it is absolutely unforgettable. But for the machinery, it is like, it is no face no more. Like, it doesn't recognize this look as a face. And obviously, like, if you go to, I don't know, any social media stream right now, from here and there you can get, if you put it on your newsfeed, you can get some more technical projects about it. Someone presenting a kind of like a shirts, for example, or coverings that also do the same thing. But what is very nice about this project that this is absolutely crazy, it shows the immense gap between the logic of these programs, yeah, and our visual sensitivities. And it shows that actually we can crash this system through design activities. This is important, yeah? So we can think of it that way, and we can do programming at all. Another part also, so they went on with this play, with this game, hide and seek game, to the moment when they established something like counter surveillance shop. It was at the time, now it is no more. When I checked it last time, it was possible to go online to the Google Adam Harvey counter surveillance shop and order, for example, invisibility cloak, a kind of this, which as we see, as we imagine, like this is this place in a different spectra. Yeah. So we had another starting move through this line of like visual spectrum, infrared, ultraviolet, and so on. That's because we started with visual cameras. And now with AI systems, and now we start, and then we move a little bit, and we are in thermal spectra, like near infrared cameras, and we see that artist is playing actually, because it is all about like let's see if it works, or let's at least let others know that there is a way actually to do this, yeah. So we can hide yourself against algorithms, but the cameras that work in extended visual spectrum. And this is something I would like to stay a bit with more. Another examples we can bring on. More and more, usually these are very ephemerical, like performances and works that use actually the technologies that are right now going into the market. Like, they are still, this is a professional equipment, something for those who work in terms of like civilian industry, for example, investigations or art restoration staff or someone who would go to the special electronic equipment, and you have lots of right now maybe not even startups, but the companies that no longer just prototype stuff, but actually they start to sell it on the market, and some of these products can be used and we can play with this not only for anti-surveillance project, but also for the project that start to show us more on a broader context of these technologies, like what does it mean to be invisible or become visible for a specific agent. Like if we think about this, the situation we are in terms of actual network theory or post-humanities approach, we know that there are lots of actors here. Humans are not the only one. Like we have biological creatures, we have machines. This is Latourian theory, Lynch, Bulgar, etc. And so here, Max Machines Incorporated Resistance Plus performance, for example, this is a performance that where again this gap between visibility and invisibility for machines and for humans is called upon. We have a flag, which is in itself an object to be seen, like to signal something. The flag has been made from the EMC, electromagnetic field scattering textile, which has been like engineered and prepared for specialized use, and works with, if you go to the characteristic of this, works with specific frequencies. So the machinery can actually, the microwave signals and also some frequencies of Wi-Fi signals can actually be dispersed. This is the rule of the Faraday cage. The simple physics is behind this. With this kind of textile, but also at the time this is super like visible for the humans. So for the humans, it's about like sending a signal and becoming visible in this performance for while in non-visual spectra, it is about like dispersing a signal again and creating a zone of silence, like building isolation. So this what we have when we go when we look at the studies and artistic interventions that happen around, and I think it is like we can collect more examples. They are not super frequent, but it happens. There is a specific group of artists and researchers who really likes to expand this surveillance study beyond the very point of human biometry presence and algorithmic power and discipline. And this is very interesting case. From the other side, we got the camouflage studies, which are less frequent here. And for the very simple, obvious reason, like we are civilians, we have no absolutely access to military technologies. We can learn something about the history of these technologies and strategies. We can also, and we like to speculate about it, but it is more of, and there is also this line in technology studies and AI studies that goes from, I don't know, from this generation of researchers who were active in the 70s, in the 80s. If you go, for example, if you take Paul Virilio's work, Paul Virilio, who is a philosopher of speed and philosopher of technology that gives a very specific and intense lesson about technology becoming a line of agency, like becoming a way to speed up different things in around us, and also technology as a set of phenomena that we should consider in connection with catastrophe. So he said that the invention of aircraft was an invention of aircraft disaster. Yeah, the invention of ship was an invention of shipwreck. So this is Virgilio. What is specific about this, like Virgilio, Hitler, theorist of media and technologies, who are from who published in the second half of 20th century, is that they really underline this connection between military experience and military not only military technologies in terms of laboratory prototyping, cutting edge, high tech, but also the experience of military actions during the Second World War, because they were young people at the time, and they kind of like these are early memories. And somewhere in the interviews with this generation, we can feel it. So they are going back to the studies. We have camouflage studies, which are not that frequent at all. When I was like doing my research on what is actually published there and what are the approaches to these camouflage studies, we have like I believe we have. According to my knowledge, we have two types of tests. One is like evolves around this question: do we have the right to hide? So this is on anti-surveillance studies camouflage, and it goes also to this artistic part, like aestheticization of life, and it is also important here for us that this is something about designing stuff. And another one, which is a very, so Islam Forsyth is one of the authors I tracked with this, is about the history of camouflage during the First World War, Second World War, but it goes to the very interesting point where you start to speak about militarization of landscape. So Islam Forsyth is a geographer, he is into humanities geography. So her background actually brings collects her argument about the around this this idea of landscape and reconfiguration of that happens actually not only in relation between the surveillance systems and our civic rights and also some interventions in aesthetics, but also how the landscape change. And here it is something that that leads up a new path that that I always invite you here during this talk to explore. So what we are left actually when you look at this camouflage studies, those are like classic examples. Right? You know, we all know this super interesting point zero stories of the dazzle camouflage, and even if you go to an like take these photos from the Dazzle Camouflage Wikipedia, and we see how the artists and the evolutionary biologists, they had discussion who came first about this camouflage, etc., etc. So, but we may also take this super classic example of from the camouflage history and put it like an argument for. Yes, there is something evidently between in the field where design, architecture, and this hide-and-seek technologies meet. Yes, there is something. It was long time ago before the technologies that are around right now. Maybe they were not totally not existing, but for sure they were not in the past use. But the idea that put lots of colorful contrast patterns and zigzags and stripes to make the ship that not to become invisible, obviously, it is super invisible, but you cannot guess the scale and the type of the vessel from this. So this was the goal. So we are left with this when we go to the studies, when we speak about our like hypothetical branch of design. And we are also, we all know what is the situation around here in Ukraine. We are also with this, like with the news coming from here and there, like giving us a hint that this concealment stealth methods are super important during the military actions that are taken around here. I don't know if you've got this news feed. This is one of the examples I can put on your table. Like last summer, when you, I got it from CNN publishing one of the reports, this went to the front line, and he, in his story, he brought the story of Ukrainian military troops finding a smart way to spot the mines. So the idea, I don't know, have you heard about this specific one? Yeah, some of you. So the story is that, if I get it right, when you use thermal imaging cameras and look at the open field during the summertime at the dusk or at the dawn when the temperature change, you got the specific image of the field, while all these parts that keep the, all these objects that keep the heat for a longer time than the soil, than the pure soil, becomes super visible. So that was, that it has been used, and this reporter, CNN reporters, tells the story that how cleverly it has been used by the military troops to spot and deactivate mines in mine. Obviously, this strategy needs some, it's not like easy plug and play stuff, because with these thermal signatures, that this is, and this is also the concept that we're going to use for our hypothetical workshop, for example, these thermal signatures for landmines in the field and for other objects, like, for example, stones, the objects with specific density can be very similar or even misleading. So what you need to do, you need to learn actually the specific condition. I think that the takeaway from this story is that if you are very careful observer, and careful, clever observer of a specific situation in the field, you can make use of this of such vision technology. So this for here the thermal imaging cameras, but at the time you have to train yourself in terms of how to read this specific environment you sit in, I spent my life in company of archaeologists. So I know a bit about how they speak about the techniques that are now being introduced in archaeology and used in archaeology in terms of like mapping and also reading the signatures of the archaeological sites. So you need to train, and it is reproduced everywhere. You go to medicine for example, to visual diagnostic, you obviously to train yourself for the specific specific configurations of objects and for this, I would say, for the specific environment here, like when you can do this, what time of the year you can do this, where it happens, how to maybe cleverly, I don't know, recognize and tell which one could be the mine and which one could be just a stone, so you don't need to lose your energy for this. So here is, and here we are left. Yeah? So we have some, here and there we have some ideas about extended registers of visibility and how they are used and what we, and we go to the next, let's say, next part of our talk today. Like, what do we have in terms of resources? Let's say, if we speak about, like, this can be the set of equipment, let's say also maybe methodologies, and also maybe some reference images, how we can actually organize it, like what we can do with this, where we can use it and how. So again, coming from the like we started with some state of the art stuff, let's go maybe right now for a quick walk and let's see what are the basic, let's say, points of reference in terms of practice and how to do. So we have this, again, this plot that tells us about like where and which frequencies, which bands are for the visible light, where we speak for which frequencies, we speak about near infrared, infrared, thermal EM, far EM, microwaves, radars, and radio. Up there we have X-rays, etc. So this is the whole nomenclature that we need to like actually observe when we go, if we go to the specifications of some technological solutions, like the data sheets, what are these data sheets actually showing us and where we can go. So basically several, like I would say these are like three or four, let's say, extensions beyond this the visual frequencies that are available to us right now. One is obviously thermal, like or even this near infrared measurements and cameras and equipment that have been so widely used during the COVID pandemic for public spaces, like measuring our body temperature to see, to just scan us on the airport or somewhere, like to see if we're more or less okay. So this is like, I would say, like rapid and poor technology with very, very low resolution. Something we can say about this change of temperatures, but they are not very precise, and this is only about the temperatures, and it happens in the near infrared spectrum, and we have some, and we already know that these cameras are with us, around us for several years. Like we start here and there in the news, and we got used to this kind of measurements and imaginary. Sometimes we can go to the resources and images, like the one that actually we decided to put on the poster for this talk, which is a stock image basically. So it is nothing sophisticated, nothing like special imaginary, nothing. It is a stock image that has been like identified in captions, like a thermal map of urban space area showing energy loss in the plant of Paris. Very, let's say, broadly speaking. The thing is that we have already these images also in the stocks right now, and and they are being sold to us and to the publishers. We can buy specific cameras not connected with our mobile devices or buy a specific model of mobile device and get some capability of capturing these images in low res, very rough resolution. But we also can buy and we can exchange and the companies that provide images for publishing today, they already know that there is a market for this kind of imagery. So this is important for us. Again, like we already got used to this practice of measuring the heat and turning it into image, and this is already in the business, let's say. Like you can say that was a fire work, that was a beautiful stock image of like near infrared image of gorilla that I spotted when I was searching for a poster image for the stock, and I liked it very much. It was too expensive. So some of these images are really also expensive. The green system. They're like a bit like artworks or like specific like they don't like it. So let's not sell it cheaply. Like let's demand the high price for it. And so in terms of like stock images, you got this full resolution because like near infrared images that measure temperature. We get wonderful mapping service that is available online that we can make use of actually, because I think this is something fantastic, and this is the resource I would like to recommend. Do you happen to use this ESA satellite imagery in your practice for some reason? You know what? When I came here, we have we have ESA, European Space Agency, and inside ESA we have like satellite mapping programs that are going on for years now. And they open their resources. When I was searching for some other reason, the sources for the satellite imagery for Kachovka Dam disasters, so most of the speeches, majority of the speeches, came from this project center. So they were like reworked by different labs, etc. But if you go, if you dig where these images were taken, by whom were they taken? So they were taken by Sentinel program, and the Sentinel program, and here we're gonna collapse the presentation. The Sentinel program is a program that has got the series of instruments. You can hear me. Okay, I'll show you. If you go there, these are as usual. It needs a while to find your way around it. But I would like to show you like two things here. If you get to this portal, that you can use it's a free access, etc. And you read the characteristics of the instruments payload. I don't know, I hope it is visible enough. So instruments that you have on this Sentinel's Copernicus 3 satellite specifically. Every satellite is specified here. You have the main instruments, Sentinel 3 Vision, Ocean and Land Color instrument, for example, ORSI. So let's see what we have here. We go to the specification of this instrument, and we know it's based on optomechanical and imagining design environments, and we go on. And here, which is very, I think, instructive, we have the whole methodology. Like we can find like lots of information about how this camera works, which specific bands of light and in what kind of which parts of electromagnetic spectrum it works and so on. So when we read about it, finally we got there's a problem with this, you know. I tried it several times, never I can do the same part. Never. So make screenshots. So I saved the link and I'm here. Okay, again it's a link. But I made a note. So all see. Instrument measures reflected solar radiation issues from Earth surface clouds simultaneously in 21 spectral bands. What does it mean 21 spectral bands? It means that it is these are spectral bands, the resolution bands that are then marked on the map, that range from the visible light to the near infrared, so 400 nanometers. 1020, so more than visible light, something more, something higher, something lower. Each of these bands is programmable in position and width, so you can you can switch between them. This is important. What is super interesting here, for example, if you go to this measurement, you can get very different kinds of maps, including like those that are captured by OTCI, where you have, for example, a mapping that gives you insight into things like features like terrestrial chlorophyll vegetation index. So what does it mean? That this is a kind of imaginary that can tell you not only about like shape, reflectance, color of the objects that it captures, but also about the chemical composition and the physical states, especially for the vegetation here. So this is something that we start to enter when we dig into this area. It's like, okay, so this extended vision, and we know it obviously, if we go for one afternoon to read about near infrared, far infrared, along the spectra, which then we will miss something, but and we have to cheat list to know which one is which. But the interesting thing is that even on such massive scale and open source data, open source imaginary, that's something that already captures not only things that you see, but the information about the composition of the things that are actually rendered by an image. So how? And it is like massive data stream and it's open. And this is not only the full technology of like temperature, gorilla, screenshot images that you can buy on stock, but this is something more serious. This is calibrated. Here you have filters that actually show you how the interference of atmospheric light goes and so on and so on. And let's collapse this presentation for a moment again. If you feel like going deeper into this, you can go to Copernicus browser, for example. I will leave the link in the source materials for you. And go to OTCI here. See how it works, like terrestrial chlorophyll index, and check out these maps. So this is why the Kapovka-Dem collapse has been like so widely published with details. And there was immediately after the disaster, there was like lots of imaginary that actually did contain some analysis of the field and how it changed, how it proceeds, etc., etc., because these instruments are free to use. And obviously, if you're a specialist, and again, some people use it on a daily basis, going back to the archaeologists, friends that they have around me, they know very well, and they actually have shown me about this rich data resources you can get in every most of regions in the world where you have like lidar, scanner, etc., etc., very precise mapping. Yeah. So here we go. Here we have another hint. We got resources for the physical state of the objects, the chemical compositions for specific layers of our environment, like for example vegetation, are quite precisely mapped. So again, something that goes beyond this biometric and so this is good. And this kind of let's say very very roughly sketched vision. So the question is, and we go to the next point, the question is whether there are any research actually who move us a bit from this point when we just are left by those who are into studies of concealment and visibility and surveillance, anti-surveillance intervention, and to some people this. Is there any practice behind it? Or are we speaking about something like completely untouched? Well, I would say not a lot, but there is some. And for example, and we can actually say where probably this kind of thinking would be introduced in terms of where you can find the very technical simple motivation for this. So one, to make this extended vision design, one, I would say, the segment of design market or engineering would be the traffic infrastructure. In terms, if you think of not even self-driving cars, but assistive technologies for driving, which are employed right now, immediately there comes up the problem of like adjustment of the infrastructure of the road, of the traffic. Like, and then you go to the publishing that actually gives you here and there, but very precise, very in one way very like geeky, technical, detailed, but on another part like composing in the bigger image, like proceedings, where you, for example, speak about the pilot projects where traffic sign technology has been tested in a way that the question was asked how to combine in one sign, because you have limited reaction time and limited space on the road, yeah? One traffic sign, how to combine the features that are easy to analyze and easy to read for the machine vision system and for the humans. And this example that comes from M3, so this is an American pilot study from US, shows something, show this. There are different paths toward it, but one particular fits into what we are speaking about here. You get a sign which can be read in infrared, and then it is the code, the Aprilia that we spoke about yesterday, yeah? The machine readable code for the sign. But the layer, since the layer is like composed of low emissive paint, it is translucent, so in a visual spectrum you don't see it, you see it in infrared, if you have an infrared camera for the reader of the car, you can like scan very briefly, very quickly the layer for the camera, and you have also, you have the same, at the same time you have the layer which is visible in RGB spectrum. So that's it. And what you do for this, actually in terms of technology, it's a very sophisticated thing, because this is more like someone finally connected these dots, because low emissive paints are around for some time, low emissive glazes and paints that actually change the thermal signature of this of such an item. So here we can go to a concept, and this is the last point of this talk, to the concept of spectral design. What would be the spectral design? So if we think about this extended resources and what we have in this extended spectrum technologies and all this bleeding, like from highly specialized, sometimes like the military work, often military purpose introduced materials and technologies. We can go, I take this, borrow this term, from the authors who published actually on military technologies from Sweden, Anderson and Akhenid, You can go to papers of these authors dating to 2014 and so on, where you have this concept of spectral design and signature map management, or spectral signature management. So we can dub it in one line. This slide is cut a bit, but we can show it in one line, which is from multispectral signatures management to multispectral signatures design. So we've had already this with the CNN topic, like, so there is a thermal signature of an object. So objects can have signatures. These signatures can be composed of different bands of electromagnetic fields. So it can be visible spectrum signature. You can extend the signature to infrared, extend it higher, and then manipulate, etc. So what is already in this, like, professional use is that you manage these signatures. So you manage the signatures, like, somewhere between an engineer and a manager, some of the system engineering maybe. So you can think, okay, if I'm into military R&D, I have to learn about the equipment against which the objects that I need to protect, to design the protection and concealment technique, what are the specifications on the other side, what can I get here, and manage the signatures. So this is the discourse of this research. Right? With the military industry and consumer technologies, you get management of the signatures. And probably if you go also, like, not probably, if you go also to this, like, industrial inspection, cameras, design, all this equipment that is, like, for technical, let's say, Industry 4.0 from Hofer Institute, my favorite, again, you go there, you have about this management. And from this management, so the question is, my question for you, how would you go from this management to design? Yeah? How would you go? And before we go to this discussion, as several points, because we said about these ranges and what we can, what kind of resources we get, and how, what is the resolution? Like, we have poor technologies, let's say, like low-risk technologies and high-risk technologies and resources are already under our fingertips. And if we think about it from the point of, like, where to start to search for our workshop or our, design brand, there are several buzzwords that come, or like inventions, come back in this discourse. So what can we use? Like, what can we get from these online shops and small companies that are very specific about this material, about this design? I think that we can get lots of super interesting materials that actually become interesting when we start to fit them into the system. Like, they've been around for a moment, but we can drag them in and use them within this design path. So one would be the Vantablatt, for example. You probably know some years ago, and here I give you also, I leave you some references. Let's see if I can make it smaller. Some references to the text that actually published these technologies, and like, will guide you if you like to search a little bit about it, not only in the commercial use, but also in terms of specification and sexual use. You can go, for example, to Vantablatt, which is nanotube carbon special pigments that actually allow you to produce a non-reflective coating. Like, if you need a black box, for some reason, like if you are catching rays of light for light for the telescope, and you don't want any light to be incidentally scattered around. If you wanna, if you are Amish Kapoor in Amish Kapoor studio and you wish to compose an installation in the Andes, then you go with Mantegast, like super black, the light is super black. And you have, and so you can go to this research that actually does something with this. And this is for the visual spectrums, but if you catch the light, you don't have the, you, it doesn't go back. Okay, but we can also think about different, not only the coatings in terms of like thinking about pigments and planes, but you can think about the structures. And there are lots of, and I would bring into this workshop microwave absorbers, radar absorbing lasers, etc., etc. Like, again, you have the set of technologies and techniques that actually allow you to compose the layers or even structures, like large scale structures or minimal large scale structures that absorb the signal in very different bands. So, quantum lux is for visual, but, yeah. But you can think about radars, and this is all again with the technologies and so on. And you can think about microwaves, and sometimes it looks like you can go not only to the absorbing inserts, but also scattering, like design and scattering of structures and layers. This acoustics, let's say, point of reference for our field would come back here, because have you ever been to a like silent camera? I don't know how to call it properly in English. When you build a room for the acoustic research, if you need to measure very precisely the characteristic of the microphones, so you get this huge, super soft like material inside, and it's absolutely no problem. Nothing. Yeah. It works like the prevention. Room or space. So last summer, when I went to communication department at my university to meet a colleague who works on radars and antennas, he was at the time he was building this kind of room, like the absolute silence for the signals, but for electromagnetic signals. So it is again, if you go to technical university, you go to the right department. So these are the structures that are being used for the research purpose. Like if you have students who are working on antennas for characteristics of antennas and so on and so on, something like generic research, you can find these materials and you can find people who know how to use them, how to compose them. So this is here. And here are EMC texts, as we already spoke a bit about. If you go to specifically, I think that German companies put on the market some of these, where you can think for designs. I think this is like beautiful, also bad because you can think about fashion industry. Although the use of these materials is very tricky, you cannot use them like the cotton fabric is directly touched, something happens in it. So, but we can also think that EMC screening materials like other technical textiles and smart textiles can be useful for this kind of design. And they are also produced in the amounts that actually surpass the very small samples, which is important. Many times when I do research, for example, on soft robotics, like this kind of new design materials, there is a catch in this, because we have this material, it's super, super interesting because it reacts for light, for example, and shrinks. Although you can produce it like a 5 centimeters long, only nothing larger. So, but here we have, the thing is that we, why the proposition of workshop is, and the design part, because already we have these technologies in provided on the scale that actually can do something with this. And obviously, when you see the thermography, again, here, maybe I repeat a bit, like we've seen it the formal images. Thermography, even in the discourse of like R&D institutes, it is called like a standard application of AR images. So this is a standard application. Like, okay, if you are into industry inspection cameras, you probably will have this kind of tool that you can go around the camera and measure all the leaks of electric car and overheating, etc., etc. And as we know, you can really do this on a large scale. So you can go to the architecture, architect studios, I don't know, or if you use this kind of inspection devices.
It's quite common.
Yeah, it is. And so map to the scale of building, actually, yeah, to the, for a large scale. And it gives us a set of here, a set of also, so what is here I put together, I bind together like machines and devices and the ways of doing, but also I would like to show that you can configure, you can start to configure, like if you have thermal cameras, you can look for for coatings and paints that are that have the specific emissivity profiles. So you can not only manage these signatures, multispectra, but you can start to build them. Like you can start to plan in a way that you build the things that have those specific qualities in a specific ranges of detection, yeah, of image capture. And it can mean lots of things, like if you can, if you think about it, like you got the 1970s and this is an oil crisis all around the world. So you need to like save the energy. And you go and you have this story. This is the moment when Philips Corporation, Philips company has introduced low emissive coatings for the glass. Because you cannot afford yourself to emit all the energy out of the building through the windows. So already then, although it has, I don't know, if it became like a mass use of or something, even then already you get this technology like, okay, so we have specific compositions of layers that you put into the glass windows and you save the energy. And here, now we have the possibility of readouts and we can use it. The only thing is like, how we combine it and for what reason. And so on, so on. Even here, I believe we can use benchmark data sets, and here I'll give you also the link for the one that works for X-ray security scanning devices, the one that we get on the airports. Like, for a designer, this is super cool. Like, all these images, I don't know if you like to look at them at the airports, I always like, kind of like, how does my luggage look like in this? But these are all, doesn't it look like online shop or shopping offer? Does it mean that like perfumes, a laptop, etc., etc., etc.? Right now, like we are starting to like go up out of the roof. Like let's say an elegant shopping with an X-ray, how to look and how to make the things that look that are not only visible but look good in this event. So, and here we go. The last point is about the hyperspectral imaging, which is a technology that actually is kind of again. All the idea with a new resolution. You get visual band, and right now on the market, you got more and more cameras that actually can register and then capture visual, extended visual spectrum, something higher and lower, like these satellites of Sentinel. But in a very continuous, nice continuous way. So you don't get just some samples. And the thing is, like, this is, I mean, obvious, but my point here is that you get an offer on the market to buy these kinds of cameras right now. Like, you can mix them, and you can make images in number of colors. You can actually upscale the resolutions of your images. Like someone who works in art restoration studio. Think about it. So you can manipulate the lens range. You can manipulate resolution. You can also go use and configure different properties of coatings and pigments, like emissivity and scattering signal scattering properties with the specific compositions. And you can, from the other side, you can prepare yourself for like composing the environment, which would be either invisible, where some elements would be either invisible or super visible. So this is highly seen, but it's also to be seen, because there is always with us this problem. People would like to be seen, and we like things to become a detectable. Yeah. So this is another side of this coin. Just by configuring all these bits and pieces that we have here. So the question is, would we have thought, and how would we do this, and what else should we think about while we get onto this kind of workshop or design path? So this question could be, thank you.
Скоріше запитання. Ну, у мене два є питання. Перш за все, дивлячись на ці налаштування якесь нормальної і ненормальної поведінки. Ми розуміємо, що є різні культури, різні лайфстайли для якогось. Для одної спільноти чи суспільства це норма, це для інших. І як оця поведінкова модель, вона може змінюється в налаштуваннях цих систем, так? Щоб розуміти, це в рамках цих норм знаходиться чи вийшло. І друге питання, це так само, як в мистецтві, оцінка того, що це є, це там рівень провокації, він якийсь ще в рамках мистецтва, чи виходить за рамки, чи як тренуються ці інтелектуальні якісь машини. І друга річ, я думаю, що вона особо актуальна в наш час в змінах клімату, це карти міст, ну, як ми, можливо, не тільки стосовно економії енергії, а також, коли ми говоримо о кліматі, зовнішньому кліматі публічних просторів, ну, і вуличних просторів, це стає дуже актуальним для урбанізму і всього, так? І ми маємо з одного боку такі карти, які робляться в день, ми бачимо ці температурні перепади, ми бачимо, де існує дискомфорт таких публічних просторах, які його показники і все інше там. І з другого боку ми маємо Building Information Modeling, чи якісь там інші програми, які є інструментами дизайну. Так? Mm-hmm. як будуються ці міст між, між умовно цими зображеннями, інформаційними даними і інструментами дизайну, як побудувати, умовно реагувати на за рахунок інструментів дизайну. Є таке поєднання між фіксацією документації цих там, не знаю, подій, якості, характеристик і якості інструментами дизайну, які з ними можуть працювати, так? І якось симулювати подальше якийсь там, не знаю, розвиток подій чи before we build.
So how to, because there's, this draft data, when you're building something change, you cannot change it anymore. Like, how can we model this in a loop? And this is, I would put it as one of the questions to, like, to take into consideration what we should take, this, because now the point is, we don't have this, like, in, as far as I know, in practice, in literature. We have to build a list of the, I would say, concerns with this experiment. What should be our concerns during this experimentation? And this thing of how to build a way of modeling interaction between this is one of the concerns. Because otherwise we will start to mess up with environment, maybe, like, we can say the effects can be not designed by, but unpredictable for us. So there's also, and which takes to the first comment that you made, are we in specific cultures of designs, designers and artists, because it is also like communities of intellect, like concept. For the philosophy of science, do we want to destabilize specific patterns, or we want to stabilize something? Are we constructive or destructive? Are we subversive, or we are, like into building functional systems? And right now, I would say that this comment. Like this concern of like predictability of our practice is more serious because it is no easy answer like how do we do this, and this is a risk of this kind of, let's say, involvement if we think about it on a large scale, because when you make a building it is serious stuff, it is not about making a plan. So we are. And, but when it comes to this, how we would, if I got you right, correct me, I got you wrong. If we ask about the communities that have different approaches and different business people, like different tempers, like what we would like to do is the same, we are not limited here, because probably, like, it can be something that could be used by those who are planning and constructing specific environments, and those who are dying. So it is like, there is no such a, I would say, and the next talk I mean about it, about the politics of this, because it gives some designers some agency and ability to manipulate the systems that enter this area of artificial intelligence systems that are data-based systems right now, connected with the cloud capital. So the next talk would be about these differences between do we play or are you serious? And I, although either we play and we are like artists or we think we go into subversive activities, intruders and artists.
Yeah, it leads to the other point, interpretation of facts. We have friend, Danish friend, writer, who wrote a book about interpretation. It's like a special profession. In order a political, I don't know, some movement or in some politician, person who differently could interpret with same facts. This is like about a huge field of manipulation, which could become from this kind of.
So we can. There is no good and bad. We can use it to commodify things and to like make actually things more oppressive. And we can use it also to play and to destabilize it. And I think that this one, this of this list of concerns, as I say, what we now put like, and how to make it in dynamic model. So how to put it in the responsive group. Yes. If and how to become reliable. In our actions. Once you put it on the list, you already declare yourself, I would say, from the constructivist part, those who look for serious consequences.
What are the best examples of multispectral imaging you can like name?
You mean in terms of resources or tools or?
Just in general, like your favorite method of using it, using the full spectrum of the book.
I would give you, like, I don't know if you know this answer, but I love this question. I get an example that I use for my visual culture teaching lessons to everyone, which is from biology, and biology of sensory systems. There are like studies of the biology of sensory systems that tell us about the minor senses, like in bats, echolocation, some senses that you have in birds, some species of birds that can navigate towards electromagnetic field, etc. And there are also stories in this book. You find stories and studies of like these are exceptional species of animals with exceptional abilities in, their, like, in terms of sensory systems. And there are crustacea, which is like marine creatures that are put in the salads. So there are some species of crustacea that have spectral vision. And so the idea of coming from the environment studies and the sensory biology is that this is the animal that has a super resolution of vision. Like we can say that human visual system is specialized in three types of sensory in our retina, sensory cells. One for red, one for green, one for blue, more or less. But these animals have 16. And the best part, so in terms of the best spectral vision, I would say the crustacea, the humble little animal, and the best part is here from biology, that they live in very, let's say, very flat environment. Like the explanation for evolution of this system is like that they're hunters, so they need to find the prey, otherwise they starve. But they're living in the habitat and zones and ecosystem underwater where you have actually everything is gray. Like everything is gray. Something to eat is gray, something that would eat you is gray, and everything is absolutely the same color. So they developed the super resolution system, like 16, spectral vision system, and they see the rainbows. Like they see different kinds of colors. Okay, this is maybe my naive interpretation of the story, which is professionally told by marine biologists and so on. But I would say that and I wouldn't like to go into this like pastoral narration, like, oh, let's make technology that is like nature that this kind of strategy can be very good for very flat, very like homogenic environments. Like that we can use the multispectral design or this extended design to play, because I'm more into this play part, to play with an experiment, very experimental part. Experiment with very homogeneous environment, like to send some signals from it. I don't know if I
Дякуємо за лекцію. Це така